It may be that for every star in the universe, there are billions of microscopic black holes streaming through the solar system, the planet, even our bodies every second. Sounds horrible. But hey, at least we'd have explained dark matter. Of the mass of our universe is completely invisible to us. Its existence is only revealed through its immense gravitational influence. This is dark matter, and it's one of the universe's most perplexing mysteries. These days, most dark matter hunters are trying to hypothesize or detect exotic new particles to explain the stuff, and we recently discussed some of the possibilities for brand new particle physics that might explain dark matter. Others are trying to find holes in Einstein's theory of gravity, the general theory of relativity, that might explain dark matter's influence without the need for actual matter. But there is one explanation that may require no new physics whatsoever, an explanation that is so bafflingly simple that it almost feels overlooked. What if dark matter is just black holes? These hyperdense holes in the fabric of space-time seem to be great dark matter candidates, being so black and holy and all. As we've discussed many times before, black holes are regions of gravitational field so intense that not even light can escape. Evidence for the reality of black holes is now pretty convincing, and we've talked about this evidence before. The fact that we know black holes are actually real seems like a significant point in their favor as an explanation for dark matter. It's more than we can say for any of the other dark matter particle candidates. So what would it take for this to be true? Well, dark matter makes up roughly 80% of the mass in the universe, but it's much more spread out than regular matter. For example, in our galaxy, it forms a vast halo around twice the diameter of the Milky Way's spiral disk, where most of the stars are found. So, for black holes to be dark matter, they'd need to be abundant enough to make up all of this mass, and they'd need to be spread out in the same way that dark matter is. In other words, most of the physical universe needs to be vast swarms of black holes that outweigh all the atoms in the universe by a factor of 4. These are the non-negotiables for black holes as dark matter. The main remaining variable is the mass of the individual black holes. We could get to the required dark matter mass with lots of massive black holes, or with ludicrously many smaller black holes. We have, of course, been trying to find evidence for black hole dark matter for some time. Any given study is sensitive to a particular range of black hole masses. And if a study doesn't find enough black holes in that range, then that mass range is ruled out as a main contributor to dark matter. Scientific method 101. Form a hypothesis, then try to prove it wrong. Our hypothesis is that dark matter is made of black holes. Today, we're going to go through the mass spectrum of black holes and close one window after another. We'll see at the end whether there are any gaps left, whether it's still possible for black holes to explain dark matter. But before we start eliminating specific black hole masses, let's rule out an entire class of black holes. In fact, we're going to rule out black holes from the only reliable astrophysical source, dead stars. We know black holes form from the remaining cores of the most massive stars after they explode a supernovae. We can make a pretty good estimate of the maximum possible number of these black holes by estimating the number of stars that formed and died through cosmic history. When we look into the distance, we're actually looking back in time, so we literally see star formation happening in the early universe. We can also see the products of these supernova explosions, not so much the black holes, but the heavy elements forged in the cores of these stars during their death throes. That star formation history and heavy element abundance tells us that there haven't been anywhere near enough supernovae to give us enough black holes to make up all of dark matter. Also, if dark matter is produced as stars die, you'd expect its influence to increase over time. But we know that dark matter has been with us from the very beginning. The density fluctuations in the cosmic microwave background tell us that the gravity of dark matter was pulling matter together long before the first stars ever formed. So, if dark matter is made of black holes, then those black holes must have been with us from the beginning. Fortunately for our hypothesis, there is a reason to think that colossal numbers of black holes may have formed in the very early universe. We call these primordial black holes. Now, we've talked about these before, but let's dig much deeper into the question of whether primordial black holes could explain dark matter. There are a few ways that primordial black holes could form, but the most mainstream mechanism is that they collapsed from density fluctuations. We know there were regions in the early universe that had a bit more matter than other regions. We see that in the cosmic microwave background from around 300,000 years after the Big Bang. Those fluctuations would have been much stronger at earlier times, and perhaps strong enough that the most massive of them would have collapsed into black holes. Now, those black holes should have all formed at around the same mass, but that mass depends on the details of the state of the early universe and could be anything from a grain of salt to tens of thousands of suns. Because of this, to really falsify the primordial black hole as dark matter hypothesis, we need to rule out this entire mass range. Okay, let's get started. We'll begin with the extreme ends of the mass spectrum. Those are easy. The most massive black holes in the universe weigh in at millions to billions of times the mass of our sun. We see these supermassive black holes in the centers of essentially all galaxies. Dark matter can't be made of these or anything close to, because these black holes tend to fall to the centers of their galaxies pretty quickly. At the opposite end of the mass spectrum, we have black holes under a billion tons, or around the mass of a small mountain. We can rule these out because by now all of these would have evaporated as Hawking radiation. Now, there's a terrifying caveat here that I'll save for the very end. We can also rule out black holes a bit larger than this as dark matter. For dark matter to be made of black holes with masses around that of a larger asteroid or a small moon, we'd need truly ridiculous numbers of them to get all of the dark matter we need. I'm talking somewhere between a billion to a billion billion times more of them than there are stars in the universe. Even though these black holes would have microscopic event horizons, at those insane abundances, they'd be wreaking absolute havoc in various astrophysical objects. For example, they'd puncture white dwarfs and neutron stars on a regular basis. A primordial micro black hole would pass right through a white dwarf, but it would deposit enough heat to allow the star's ultra-dense carbon and oxygen to undergo nuclear fusion. Like striking a match, this would ignite a cataclysmic chain reaction, exploding the star as a type 1A supernova. Neutron stars are a bit different. They're so dense that they would stop a microscopic black hole in its tracks. The black hole would then swallow the neutron star from the inside out. But we see too few type 1A supernovae and too many neutron stars for this to be a common phenomenon. Probably no more than a few percent of the dark matter mass can be from these micro black holes. Okay, let's move up the black hole mass spectrum to masses around that of a planet. At this point, gravitational lensing becomes the go-to method for dark matter hunters. When a compact mass, like a black hole, passes in front of a distant light source, the warped space-time around the black hole acts like a lens, magnifying the source in an effect called microlensing. Microlensing doesn't necessarily tell you whether the lensing object is a black hole or some other dark compact mass like a brown dwarf star, a neutron star, a Dyson sphere, or a cluster of Reaper capital ships. As long as they're massive, compact, and dwell in vast numbers throughout the halo of the Milky Way, watching and waiting. Broadly, we call this breed of dark matter candidate machos, massive, compact, halo objects. The best way to search for machos in our galaxy is to monitor the stars in the galactic bulge or in our neighboring galaxies to see if they fluctuate in brightness due to microlensing. A dedicated telescope on Mount Stromlo in Australia pioneered this work throughout the 90s. The very first macho microlensing events were detected, but there weren't nearly enough to account for dark matter. Since then, further surveys have really nailed down the constraints. The Magellanic Clouds are especially good for this. The low level of microlensing of stars in these mini galaxies has allowed us to rule out machos between roughly the moon's mass to 10 or so times the mass of the sun as a main contributor to dark matter. But even if machos aren't all of dark matter, studies of the Magellanic Clouds and Andromeda have found enough microlensing events to suggest that 20% of the mass of the Milky Way halo may be dark compact objects with the masses of a small star. And we can't rule out these as primordial black holes, nor as Reapers, but there's no good evidence of either. So far, we've mostly ruled out black holes around the sun's mass or lower as an explanation for dark matter. Larger black holes are tricky because you need fewer of them to make up the mass of dark matter, which means they're less likely to be spotted through microlensing studies. As I mentioned, the most massive black holes trickle to the center of our galaxy, but there's an intermediate mass range from tens to thousands of solar masses that could still be abundant throughout the Milky Way. One way to test that is to look at dwarf galaxies. These galaxies are so small and dense that even black holes with tens of solar masses should have trickled to the center by now, and in the process flung less massive stars into higher orbits. Studies of the structures of dwarf galaxies tell us that no more than 4% of the dark matter could be black holes of tens to thousands of solar masses. The existence of loosely bound binary star systems throughout our galaxy gives us similar constraints. If there were lots of black holes of several tens times the Sun's mass, then these binaries would long ago have been torn apart by close encounters. Okay, so there we have it. We have some evidence ruling out most of the black hole mass spectrum as the main source of dark matter. There are a few narrow windows remaining, but these are just the windows where our studies are less sensitive. And frankly, it's unlikely that it just so happens that all of dark matter is packed into the spots we haven't properly looked at yet. So dark matter probably isn't black holes. But don't be sad. That means dark matter is probably something that physics hasn't explained yet. Which means when we figure it out, we'll have a window into new physics. And who knows what we'll find there. But speaking of new physics, one last option. It's speculated that an evaporated black hole might leave behind a tiny, naked singularity, a speck of infinite density weighing less than a grain of salt. These so-called Planck relics are bad news as dark matter because they're essentially undetectable, and also because there would have to be at least a few in the room with you right now. Whatever the case, dark matter is freaky stuff, fitting as the main material ingredient of our generally freaky space-time.